We pray for blessings. We pray for peace, comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity, and we pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering. All the while you hear each spoken need, yet love us way too much to give us lesser things. But what if your blessings come through the raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? And what if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? For wisdom, your voice to hear, and we cry in anger when we cannot feel you near. We doubt your goodness, we doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not enough. While you hear each desperate plea and long that we'd have faith to believe. But what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're your mercies in disguise? When friends betray us, when darkness seems to win, we know the pain reminds this heart that this is not our home. Nights are your mercies in disguise.
Good morning. Welcome to the third Sunday after Pentecost worship service. Happy Father's Day. We are thankful for all men who have been a positive influence in our lives. Now, Pastor John has a few things he would like to say.
I have two announcements, or two things to share. Catherine had an errand she had to run, so I'm looking for a ride to get home a night. So if somebody can help me with that, talk to me after the service. The second is that this past week, I got to see the oncologist again after many months, and the CT scan showed that the anti-cancer drug that I'm on is killing the cancer. So that's good news. And the MRI showed that it was stable. So that's also good news. So that's my announcement. So thank you.
We encourage you to take your bulletins home after the service to review announcements and note upcoming events on your calendars. I'll highlight a few. One announcement that is not in your bulletin. There'll be a cleanup of the refreshment stand in the park on Friday, June 23rd, this week, beginning at 1 p.m., including washing all the surfaces to prepare the stand for the summer season. The more help we have, the faster we can get done. Bring some cleaning rags. If you know you can help, let John or Jane Leeser know. But if it turns out last minute it works out for you, please come out to help on Friday, the 23rd at 1 p.m. Next Sunday, June 25th, our worship service is scheduled to be in the park, including a baptism. If inclement weather or unsafe air quality due to smoke conditions from the Canadian fire again, as we had a couple of weeks ago, the service will be moved to the sanctuary. Services are scheduled to be in the park on the 2nd, 4th, and 5th Sundays through August. Use the park benches, bring lawn chairs, or listen to the service on your car radio. Plan to stay after the June 25th service for a picnic in the park. There will be a light picnic menu of foods, hot dogs, hamburgers, pasta salad, and a soup sale. There'll be lawn games and kids' activities, including cornhole, gaga ball, and volleyball. More details are in the bulletin. This event is not just for members, so spread the word so friends and neighbors to drop in anytime and enjoy an afternoon in the park. Also, we want to honor all our graduates, so please provide the information listed in the announcement to the office about any of our member families who have graduates from high school, college, or any other special programs. Review the information and requirements about the Jean Reinert Memorial $1,000 scholarship, since June 30th is the deadline to apply for any high school senior pursuing additional vocational or a college and has been an active member of HUFS since confirmation. Plans for the July 22nd picnic in the park are underway. Please see in your bulletin all the times that help is needed to prepare the days before the picnic and the day of the picnic. Sign-up sheets are available now as you exit, so please sign up as soon as you can so we can be sure we have enough help for this big event. An announcement not in your bulletin is that Village Volleyball and or Gaga Ball will be held in the park from 6:30 to 8 p.m. on the first and third Wednesdays of July and August. This is for all the community, so please invite friends and neighbors to drop in, all ages and abilities. There's a sign-up sheet for volunteers to host the games on the bulletin board downstairs. Hosts open the restrooms, get out the balls, and set up a water cooler and welcome the players. Then we will begin our service and invite you to stand as you are able for the ringing of the bell and the call to worship. Call to worship. Jesus Christ summons us to answer God's call of mercy Christ gathers us and gives us power to be healed and to heal, to be forgiven and to forgive, to be freed from sin and to set others free, to tell one another and the world. God's presence is at hand. Let us worship God. Let us pray together. God of wonder, you appeared to Abraham as three persons. You reveal their witness in your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit fills your people with hope through the peacemaking cross of Jesus. Gather us as Christ's faithful disciples and empower us with his good news. In the name of our Lord, Jesus Christ. Amen. We'll sing hymn number 554 in the Green Hymnal. Please be seated. We'll affirm our faith by saying together the Apostles' Creed, printed in your bulletin. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The children are invited to sit in the front pew for the children's message with Julie and then go to Sunday school downstairs.
It's so good to see you. Oh my goodness. All right, I'm going to give you a Bible verse in honor of Father's Day. Honor your father and your mother. Exodus 20:12. So, you guys look pretty smart. What do you think honor means? What do you think? Respect? Okay. Well, anyway, let's do some examples. I have some pictures here. And since there's only two of you, it'll be so much easier to see them because I couldn't print them up, of course. Now, this is in a classroom. They're honoring their teacher by doing what? Exactly. Because if they would all be talking at the same time, would that be honoring their teacher? No. Okay, let's go to another one here. Let's see. Come on, move. I'm going to make it smaller and move. Here's a good one. Now, I think you remember a couple of weeks ago, we honored soldiers in the cemetery. They did a shooting of the guns, and that was called a 21-gun salute, I believe. And then they sang some songs. But how do, like when we pledge to the flag, how do we honor the flag? What do? Show me. Do you ever do the Pledge of Allegiance? Do you do the Pledge of Allegiance? Yes, very good. And when soldiers that are in the military address the flag or the president or maybe their sergeant, what do? Yes, just like that guy's doing in the picture there. Oh, did the scouts do it too? I was a Girl Scout. I don't remember. I think we used to put our hand up. Okay, here's another one. And I've never really seen this myself, so I had to bring a picture. And these people are all standing up because a judge entered the courtroom. Did you ever see on TV? Everybody goes, "All rise." And then everybody stands up when he comes in and they sit down because he's an important person and people want to make sure they honor him by showing him respect. So one more. Let's see what I got here. Keep going. Oh, I think you'll know that one. What are they doing? Yeah, but what are your... Yes. And it's just like when you go to school and you see a friend, what do? To honor them.
I usually go up and hug them.
Oh, well, yeah. Let's turn around, everybody. Hi, everybody. See? I'm honoring people that I care about by waving at them and acknowledging them. So that's one way of honoring them. So... for Father's Day, let's see, where are we at? What do you think we should to do in our own words? What do you think we should do to honor our fathers for Father's Day? It's true, but I have a sign from sign language. I was looking it up. One thing we can do. What does that mean? Do you know what that means? Yes, you guys got it. Yes, they listen to our father because our father always tries to give us some really good advice, like don't eat candy and cookies for breakfast. You know, that's, oh, come on. Or maybe you should clean up your room. Oh yeah, I know, let's play a game. I'm going to ask you if it's a way of honoring anybody, you know, I'll ask you a question. And if it's a way of honoring somebody, you salute me and stand up and salute me, okay? But if it's not a way of honoring, what's a way of not, of showing that you don't honor somebody? Go like that? Okay. All right. You think you're ready for this? All right. Let's see. How about giving your father and mother a hug when they come in from work? You can stand up and salute. Yeah, that's a good one. All right, it wasn't a trick question. All right, asking your dad to play with you. What do you think? Oh, she's saying no. Okay, he's saying yes. All right, everybody has their own opinion. Okay, now, getting upset with your dad when he does not have the time right now to play with you. That's not respect, I guess, no. Asking your father to pray with you at bedtime. Definitely. That's honoring him. Okay. Getting angry with your father when he asks you to do your chores. That's not honoring him. So one way of honoring parents is to listen to them. So today is Father's Day. And remember, God gave us him as a gift. And we are so thankful that we have a great father. So we can give a gift to our dad today by listening to him. I can do the sign for, I think, Happy Father's Day with one hand. Do you know how to do happy? Go like this. Happy Father's. And day is, no wait, it's a D. Is that a D? D, you go like this. Day, you wanna try it? Alrighty. Happy Father's, make the D, D. Day, you got it, all right. Now let's talk about a sign that we make to God when we are honoring him, when we talk to him. What do? I'm doing it, but I have a microphone in my hand, sorry. We fold our hands. Yeah, so let's say a little prayer. Are you ready? Dear God, repeat after me. Go ahead, dear God. Thank you for your love. Thank you for giving us our Father. Help us to honor our Father. Very good. And amen. Say that real loud.
Amen.
That was great. So now wait a minute. Before you go, I want to honor you by passing along a fist bump blessing. How does that sound? God bless you. Thank you so much for your help. God bless you. So, yes, don't forget that sign and this one especially, okay? Maybe he'll, like, when you get home, he'll go, So thank you very much. You can go to Sunday school. Do they have Sunday school? Okay.
We'll continue in the bulletin with a gathering of our offerings. Jesus gathered disciples and gave them authority to heal the sick, cast out evil, and proclaim the good news. Let us present our offerings for the mission of the church, bearing witness to the kingdom of God. Thank you. Let us pray together for God's blessing on all our offerings. Blessed Trinity, three-part harmony, in you those who sing for joy reveal in all your glory, and those who cry in pain find comfort in their sorrow. Thank you for being God with us. Thank you for keeping your promises to our faith ancestors and to us. Thank you for coming near to us in your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you for hope that brings life through the empowering of your Holy Spirit. Thank you for the love you hold up before the world on the cross of Christ. Even our offerings come from the fruits of your blessings. Praise you, God. Thank you, Holy Glory to your name, O God Most High. Amen. Please be seated. The first scripture reading is from Genesis chapter 18, verses 1 through 15. The Lord appeared to Abraham near the great trees of Mamre, while he was sitting at the entrance to his tent in the heat of the day. Abraham looked up and saw three men standing nearby. When he saw them, he hurried from the entrance of his tent to meet them and bowed low to the ground. Abraham said, "If I have found favor in your eyes, my Lord, do not pass your servant by. Let a little water be brought, and then you may all wash your feet and rest under this tree. Let me get you something to eat so you can be refreshed and then go on your way, now that you have come to your servant." "Very well," they answered. "Do as you say." So Abraham hurried into the tent to Sarah. "Quick," he said, "get three seahs of the finest flour and knead it and bake some bread." Then he ran to the herd and selected a choice, tender calf and gave it to a servant who hurried to prepare it. He then brought some curds and milk and the calf that had been prepared and set these before them. While the three visitors ate, Abraham stood near them under a tree. Where is your wife Sarah?" they asked him. "There in the tent," he said. Then one of them said, "I will surely return to you about this time next year, and Sarah, your wife, will have a son." Now Sarah, listening at the entrance to the tent, which was behind him, Abraham and Sarah were already very old, and Sarah was past the age of childbearing. So Sarah laughed to herself as she thought, "After I am worn out and my Lord is old, will I now have this pleasure?" Then the Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh and say, 'Will I really have a child now that I am old?' Is anything too hard for the Lord? I will return to you at the appointed time next year, and Sarah will have a son." Sarah was afraid, so she lied and said, "I did not laugh." But he said, "Yes, you did laugh." The gospel reading is from Matthew chapter 9, verse 35 through chapter 10, verse 8. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles: first, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew; James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John; Philip and Bartholomew; Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector; James, son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus, Simon the Cananean, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Do not take a road leading to Gentiles, and do not enter a Samaritan town, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those with a skin disease, cast out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Every congregation I have served has wanted to bring new people into the church. Most times the core reason behind this desire has been to bring new people into fellowship with Jesus Christ. Jesus does welcome those outside the church to come and follow me. This inclusive welcome is offered to those society views as outcasts, people whom elites in society reject and attack, people who are unlikely to be able to help with a church budget. From when the earliest Jesus communities formed in the first century to the present day, the church has always been called to radical inclusion. This welcoming attitude, this way of being that embraces those outside to come and be fully included, is one key difference between a church and a social club. As Abraham welcomed the three travelers as honored guests, so too do congregations welcome those who find themselves at our doors, a welcome that is more than a pleasant and polite greeting, a welcome that is the beginning of a journey towards deep friendship and affirming attachment. What begins with welcome becomes inclusion as the new person becomes an integral member of a fellowship that fully embraces them. Made in the image of God, persons are welcomed and affirmed for who they are as they are. Joined together in Jesus Christ, each finds a holy place where former insider-outsider distinctions are no more. United by the Holy Spirit, we experience a spiritual attachment and embrace toward one another that, as Jesus told us, can even transcend the bounds of family. The radical inclusion that happens in a Jesus community affirms the unique gifts and personhood of each person. This is certainly much more than being connected to each other through working on various committees to keep an organization going. One word for this radical inclusion is hospitality. Hospitality was especially important, even life-saving, in desert cultures such as Abraham's. Upon seeing the three travelers, Abraham first offers them water and shade. The scriptures mentions a little water to wash their feet. Of course, water first quenches thirst before it is used to wash feet. So fresh water to drink is assumed. Abraham also offers his guests a place to rest under the shade of a tree. Food is prepared, baked bread cakes, a tender calf, cheese, and milk are shared with the three guests. The guests then share that they will return, and when they do, Sarah will have given birth to a son. This comes to pass and is why the church tradition views these three guests as being angels, though in our scripture this morning, the Lord. I've served more than a dozen congregations, and I've experienced vastly different hospitality styles. I have been at local churches that really excel at hospitality, and at those that have made radical inclusion and hospitality key to their identity as followers of Jesus Christ. I've also been at churches that have worked hard to improve their welcome, even as this was difficult. Abraham didn't see the three travelers and think to himself, "Look, three angels. I better get the best calf and offer them excellent hospitality." He began by greeting them with a bow and shared the same hospitality he would give to any travelers in that ancient desert culture. When we first express welcome to a new person, we don't know them yet. As we extend radical inclusion toward them, we begin to become aware of who they are and the spiritual gifts they bring. As we embrace them into this local Jesus community and fully affirm them for who they are, the gifts that they bring are unlocked and shared in ways that enrich both themselves and the whole community. Next week will mark 1 year since my candidate sermon and being called to be your pastor. Having served many congregations as an interim pastor, I know how to enter and establish a ministry presence in a new place. I had a basic plan for my first year. Based on my experience, I was confident that if I followed what worked well elsewhere, a strong foundation would be built for being your pastor at Huff's Church. However, this past year has not gone the way I hoped, planned, or envisioned. There are things in life you just can't plan. As one person in a previous church put it, "It is what it is. She has dementia. This was not how she envisioned her elderly years to play out. It is what it is." The way that Abraham expressed radical hospitality toward those three travelers is the way I have felt. You have treated me from my first day here and every day since. Genuine welcome, inclusion, and support. Now, a person hearing this might say, "Well, he might not be an angel, but he is your pastor. So of course you all would welcome, include, and embrace him. Of course you would show your pastor the radical hospitality that Abraham showed the travelers in the Genesis passage." Now, having served at many local churches, I can tell you that hospitality cannot be assumed or assured just because you're a pastor. Although being the pastor does at least help people remember your name. This has not been how I hoped or planned my first year here would unfold, but in some ways, it has been much more than I could have ever envisioned. Let me share what I mean by that. When I came out of the hospital at the end of March, I was quite weak, weaker than I think I've ever been in my life. I'd already missed lots of time in the previous months due to reactions to treatments and medications for the cancer. And now, unrelated to the cancer, my gallbladder had really knocked me out. I was exhausted. I was on home nursing care, which means, except for seeing doctors, of course, I was homebound. And some of those doctor visits were done on the internet because I was too weak to go there in person. I really wondered at that time if I would be able to continue being a pastor. By able, I mean physically capable. Not because I didn't want to be your pastor, not because I was spiritually depleted or mentally burnt out. Would I become physically strong enough to be capable of doing what a pastor does? I seriously considered the possibility that I had hit an obstacle that I wouldn't be able to overcome. It is what it is. Halfway into April, I finally had the strength to start opening all the cards people at Huff's had sent me. Lots and lots of cards. And I knew that there was a prayer behind each card. I felt your hospitality, your love, your embrace. I resolved that if God gave me the strength, I was going to continue forward as your pastor. This was not an act of willpower on my part. I had gone through and depleted all of my "I'm going to will this to happen" months before. This was a mix of your hospitality and prayers, my slowly gaining strength, and living into God's call. Something much deeper than my willpower. A combination of doing the exercises the physical therapist gave me with the spiritual energy that just recharges you. I'm here today because I continue to go to physical therapy and continue to do those exercises and continue to grow stronger. That is part of it. I am also here today because of the radical hospitality that you offered me when I was at my lowest point. Thank you. Now, Abraham offered those three travelers a tender calf and cheese. You offered me cards and prayers. Well, back in March, I didn't want to eat anything. And in April, I had no desire to eat a cheeseburger. What I needed was cards and prayers. I don't need to teach you how to offer radical hospitality to others. You already know how to do this. My only hope with this sermon is to inspire you to offer the same hospitality you extend to me others as well. People God sends to us as angels, even if they don't know it themselves. Amen. Jesus said, "Come to me, all you who are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Let us stand as we are able. 357.
Thank you.
we are gathered in prayer this morning, we pray, dear God, that you might give us a spirit of radical inclusion and welcome, and extend this to all the new people who might show up at our doors, and extend it to one another. For you bring angels in our midst unawares. We ask that we might treat each other as we would want to treat an angel, that we might be a people that bring Jesus Christ's welcome and inclusion to a hurting world. In prayer this morning, we lift up those who are ill in body, mind, or spirit. For myself, Pastor John, for my wife, Catherine, for Bobby, Frank, Belinda, Pearl, Jared, Peter, Jessica, others whom we name in our hearts. We ask, dear God, that you might pour out your healing power on each of these people and bring them to your wholeness. We ask that you might inspire us to hold these people in our prayers, to send them cards, to be part of their healing process, a process of healing that Jesus in our scripture today empowered us as his disciples to bring to people who are hurting and in need of healing. We ask, dear God, that you might make us ever faithful disciples of Jesus Christ, that you might empower us to bring the gospel to this time and place in ways that we might not even envision. For it is not our plan, but your plan that unfolds. It is what it is a way of saying it is your will, not our will. We ask these prayers in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins.
Please join in the responsive reading of the Disciples' Pledge in your bulletin. We love God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. We pledge our whole selves to God. We love our neighbors as ourselves. We pledge to do justice as Christ's ambassadors of reconciliation. We love one another as Jesus loves us. We pledge to be and become Christ's beloved community in our life together. We make disciples by teaching and modeling how to follow Jesus' way of love. We pledge to be Jesus' disciples, sharing Jesus' way of love in the way we live our lives and practice our faith. Please stand as you are able for the benediction.
In my last church, before I give the benediction, that person said, it is as it is, or something to that effect. It is what it is. So often that it became something that we in our family just kept saying. This last week, I was telling Catherine, I just don't think I have a voice. She said, it is what it is. The three persons of the Trinity surround you. The hand of God keep you from all harm. The Spirit of God guide you in all joy. The Son of God deliver you to eternal life. Go in peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.